just shuffling of soldiers' feet as they guarded the grave. One day, 2 days, now 3 days near past. Could it be that Jesus had breathed his last? Or could it be that his father had forsaken him, turned his back on his son, despising our sin? All of hell seemed to whisper, just forget him, he's dead. But then the father looked down to his son and said,
arise, my love, arise, my love. The grave no longer has a hold on you. No more guessing, no more suffering. Arise, arise, my love.
The earth trembled and the tomb began to shake, and like lightning from heaven that stone was rolled away. And as dead men, the guards, they just stood there in fright, as the power of love displayed its might.
Then suddenly a melody filled the air, riding wings of love, it was everywhere.
The words of creation had been longing to hear, the sweet sound of victory, so loud and clear.
verse up on the screen that really inspired this song. And I don't know what it is that you're dealing with. This talks about some of the hurts and the pains that we have to endure. But it says that weeping endures for the night, but joy comes in the morning. And I was thinking just a minute ago, what's new every morning of our life? According to Lamentations, the mercies of God. And as the class and I looked at this morning, there are places where the mercy of God, it says His mercy endureth forever. And that word, I read one place, said is His mercy, His grace, and His covenant love for His people. So when the morning comes, we're reminded of the mercies of God. We're reminded of the grace of God. And we're reminded that He loves us. So I told somebody before, I said, you know, I don't know if this song is for me or if it's for anybody else, but if you're in a hard time right now, if you're battling something, if you're discouraged, if you're just tired, you may be weeping right now, but the morning is coming because we serve a great God who cares about us, who loves us. And so you worship with me this morning. Seem to hide the hurt written on your face. You're broken inside, longing for love's embrace. It might be a while before you smile, I know, 'cause I fought that fight. And weeping may endure for the night, but it's almost morning. Joy will replace the tears, calm all your darkest fears. It won't be long till the dawn. Tomorrow's another day to live free of all your pain. So don't give up on your faith, 'cause it's almost morning. I've been where you are. I've had my heart break too. I've cried in the dark. I can relate with you. I have prayed to see the sun break free while the storm's still in sight. So when the darkness consumes the guiding light, remember that it's almost morning. Joy will replace the tears, calm all your darkest fears. It won't be long till the dawn. Tomorrow's another day to live free of all your pain. So don't give up on your faith, 'cause it's almost morning. It's almost morning. Joy will replace the tears, calm all your darkest fears. It won't be long till the dawn. Tomorrow's another day to live free of all your pain. So don't give up on your faith, 'cause it's almost morning. No, don't give up on your faith, 'cause it's almost morning.
I believe that. I believe Jesus is coming soon. And what they're doing in the Middle East, the direction of the world, they can't stop it. He's not going to come any quicker than he had already planned, any later than they already planned. But it sure does feel like it's getting gloriously dark in this world. Turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6. And this week, next week, we're going to finish that series on our family, our marriages, our children, and our church. And this morning we're talking about God's plan for parenting. We have, and there are many great parenting books. If you're going to be a parent or are now a parent, I could recommend several books by James Dobson. Raising a Strong-Willed Child, that's a big help. Raising Boys, Bringing Up Girls. There are several that James Dobson has written, and there are several Christian books that you can find that can help you with raising your children. The Bible teaches us when it comes to the things that we do as Christians that we do it differently than the world. In Leviticus chapter 18, this is what God said to the children of Israel. He said, don't do things like you saw in Egypt, and don't do things like they do in the land of Canaan where I'm taking you. He said, but my statutes and my laws, he said, do what I say, do it the way that I say. And as Christians, this is what we do. We don't raise children like the world raises children. We don't do what is the social norm. As Christians, we have found a better way. We don't do it by modern psychology. We do it the Bible way, and that is the best way because God knows. God knows you. God knows your children. God knows what they need. God knows what every child needs, and God knows how to help them. So this morning in Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 4, the Bible tells parents his plan, his biblical plan for parenting. And you fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. Bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. The word fathers here is a word that has been translated throughout the New Testament in Greek as well as parents. So when it says fathers here, it's of course putting the leadership on the father, but it's including the mother in that they are to bring up the children in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. Provoking not your children to wrath. And let me tell you a little bit of about what Paul is fighting here, the culture of that day. And remember that we're fighting a culture in our day. He's fighting a culture in his day. There was a law, a Roman law called Patria Potesta, the father's power. If the father so decided, he could sell his children into slavery. If he so decided, he could put his children in chains and make them work in his shop or in the fields. If he so decided, he could execute his own children without the government stepping in. If he had a child and they laid the child at his feet and he picked that child up and received that child and acknowledged that child, then that child would live there in the home and they would bring him up. If that child, boy or girl, was rejected by him for any reason, for deformities, for any physical ailment, for any reason, if he rejected that child was then set on the street. People would come by and pick those children up and they would sell them into slavery. They would use them for all kinds of evil purposes. And some would put them into orphanages and try to raise them right. In fact, there is a letter that is written by a Roman soldier. And this letter written by that Roman soldier kind of gives you an idea of the times in which Paul was writing to the church at Ephesus and Galatia and all of these groups that had been conquered by the Roman Empire. This is what he writes to his wife in 1 BC. He says, heartiest greetings. Now that we are still in Alexandria, don't worry if others return and I remain in Alexandria. I beg and beseech you that you take care of the little children. And as soon as I receive wages, I will send them to you. If you have a child while I'm gone, if she was pregnant and he didn't know it, he says, if you have a child, it's a boy, let it live. If it is a girl, throw it out. This is the day in which Paul was writing. God showed the Christians, this is not my way. This is not God's way. Instead, God said when it came to the little children, when Jesus walked on this earth, when it came to the little children, he said, it'd be better for you to take a millstone and tie it around your neck and throw yourself into the ocean than to hurt one of these little ones. God had a different way. God had a Bible way. It was God's way in the way which they raised children. The boys that were set out and that they didn't want were sold into slavery. Or the boys were taken in to be trained to be gladiators and killed in the Colosseum. Or the boys were sold to the wealthy of that day for pedophilia. The girls were taken out, of course, as slaves and prostitutes. Little girls, little boys, brought up into a wicked world and found themselves with no choice other than to be at the mercy in the hands of wicked, wicked men. Not much has changed in America. 20,000 to 50,000 children in our country are used for pornography. It's wicked. That is a demonic thought that I cannot even imagine. A third of our children in America are placed into foster care because the parents are either too high or too lazy or don't care to take care of their children. Millions are raised by the television. And this is what they have found out, all the minds that have come together. This is what they have found out. There are four things that if they are in the child's life, it will help that child to keep from falling into delinquency. Four things that if are involved in a child's life, that child is probably not going to end up being a delinquent. Number one, the father's discipline. Firm, fair, and consistent. Number two, the mother's supervision. She wants to know where they are and what they're doing. Were we not taught that by our parents? When I got my license, I could not just grab my keys and head out the door. Dad told me, he said, wherever you're going, I want to know where you're going, I want to know what you're doing, I want to know who you're doing it with, and I want to know what time you'll be home. He said, I'm not asking you, but if you come home, you won't have those keys for very long without telling me or your mother where you are, who you're with, and what you're doing. So I had to find them before I left the house. Say, Dad, going to work, be home at 10. Dad, going to school, going to basketball practice. He said, it's not my job, it's your job to tell me where you're going. Amen. This is not a Bible thing. This is what society and socialists have sociologists have found out. The father in his discipline is fair and firm and consistent. The mother, her supervision over the children, she wants to care for them and nurture them and make sure they're taken care of. And then there is affection in the life of that child administered. They're told that they are loved, and those children know that they're loved. Number four, there's family cohesion. The family does things together. The family eats together. The family hangs out together. The family spends time together. It's not just a depot where one comes in, the other goes out, and they're never together. They're never spending any time together. So when it comes to the verse that says, provoke not your children to wrath, or provoke not your children to anger, it means don't frustrate these children. These children are yours. And they need to be taught. They have to be taught. And it is your responsibility to teach them. There's a book that came out back in the 70s called The End of Childhood. I believe I grew up in the 70s as a child and then into the 80s. And I believe the 80s was the last decade of childhood. And this is the reason for it. When we were kids and we spent the day, we would go out into the neighborhood and play games. We played games like rollerbat, stickball, streetball, usually involving a ball. If we didn't have a ball, sometimes we would take our socks off, roll them up, duct tape them together, and use it as a ball. You ever done that? Made a ball out of whatever you had. The bases were somebody's shirt or somebody's ball glove, and we would play. No supervision, there was nobody there. We were out in the neighborhood playing. We knew what we'd get if we got home and were in trouble. And Mom always said, you'd be home by the time the street lights come on. And if we weren't, we knew what was coming. Are you listening to me? You go through your neighborhoods now on a beautiful day, and you'll not see one child outside. What happened? Electronics and the media. I'm not saying that's a bad thing. Everything that's done can be used for good or it can be used for evil. But what happened is television entered our lives in the 50s and the 60s, and it changed childhood. Now children have access to things they should not have access to and should be sheltered from. But that television and media, now the internet and all of the social media, opens up their minds to adult things that they should be innocent of and should be sheltered from for a little while so they can keep that innocent childlike mind until they are taught and they're able to find themselves experiencing adulthood when they're ready for adulthood. We used to read books like Dick and Jane, See Spot Run. Remember those? Now they want to place in our libraries pornographic materials to teach children how to perform sexual acts. You know this. You've seen it on the news. So Paul's day is much like our day. It's become wicked, and we don't do it like the world does it. We do it like God teaches us to. Provoke not the children to wrath. Parenting, I want you to know, is frightening. It is expensive. It costs you time, and it costs your talents, but it is worth it to parent your children. Not just to take care of them so DSS doesn't take them away, but really parent your children. DSS won't take them if they're clothed and fed well. They won't take them. They don't see that they're spending hours on video games. They don't see if they're spending hours in front of a television. They don't see if they're spending hours away from mom and dad or being neglected. They don't see all of that. And I want you to know, parenting is something that every Christian, when you have a child, parenting comes with you protecting the mind of your child as long as you can from the wickedness of this world until they're able to handle it. And even then, they may not be able to handle it. 3 million children, and I'm talking about under the age of 12 when I say children, 3 million children watch television between 11 and 11:30 at night. Now, what we've done with programming is they used to push all the bad programs to 9 o'clock. Some of y'all remember these days when the schedule came up, and Dallas didn't come on till 9 o'clock because it was adult material. Now Dallas seems tame compared to what's on TV now. I didn't watch it. I was a little kid. And when, well, of course, Mom didn't watch it much, but when it came on, I didn't want to watch Dallas. I liked the Dukes of Hazzard. I liked Fantasy Island, and I liked those shows. So you know what I did? I went and played. We made up games. Me and my brothers made up games. Children's lack of imagination is because they're put in front of a screen from the time that they're young, and that screen tells them what to think and tells them what to do. 2.1 million children watch television from 11:30 to 12:30. 1.1 million children watch television from 12 to 1 a.m. 750,000 children in America watch television even as late as 1 a.m. to 1:30 a.m. There's no dividing line with the television. You just push the button, and you have access to every sin, every wickedness, every word, every scene, every act. Television has no secrets. Social media has no secrets. And the age of childhood is lost, and the innocence of that child is lost watching something they should not see, or on the internet seeing things they should not see. A pastor's wife that I know, and a pastor that I know dearly, the first time that his son was exposed to pornography, he was sitting with his mom when they were doing a school project. You know, most men are introduced to pornography by accident. None of them go looking for it, but at a young age, some friend has a magazine, some friend shows them something. We don't go looking for it. You men know this, but it is an addictive, vice that men can get involved in. And they sit down to look up the life cycle and reproduction habits of the butterfly. That's what she typed into Google or Word Search or whatever she typed into Internet Explorer. And all kinds of pornographic material came up. She had turned her eyes and was watching the television program, and the little boy started tapping. At 12, the little boy started tapping his mom. I said, "Mom, Mom, Mom, Mom." He knew that shouldn't have been on the computer screen. The pornographers are so bad that if you have a website and you don't keep that domain name, they'll take that. Even churches, even ministries, they'll take that domain name and turn it into a pornographic website, because they know if they can get the heart of that young boy very early, they've got him the rest of their life. And it's a multi-billion dollar industry in America. The age of childhood has ended, and if you're not careful as a parent, Satan will do his very best to take it from them. Now let me say, when it comes to this verse, provoke not your children to wrath, let me tell you some things that parents do wrong, and this is what provokes children to frustration and anger and bitterness. And you can see it in your children. You know I've seen parents take their child and to go to punish them in corporal punishment. Now, you know God agrees with that, and I agree with that. To a certain extent, you have to know your child first before you go and spank them. But I've seen parents take a child up and just start wailing on them out of anger and frustration. And the little kid is saying, "What I do? What I do? What I do?" When they say that, you're doing it wrong. That kid doesn't know what they did. You need to stop and tell that child what they did before you go spanking them. Maybe they didn't know they weren't supposed to do that, or maybe they did know and they did it anyway. You as a parent, it takes more time to parent than it does just to raise a child. You parent a child, the Bible teaches us you don't provoke him to wrath. Number one, you're not overprotective. You're not always keeping them from making mistakes and doing wrong. Failure is a great teacher. When I was tying my shoes, I tied them several different ways and it didn't work, and I realized that's not the way to do it. Favoritism. Unrealistic expectations of them. Overindulgence. Picking up for them, and when I mean overindulgence, picking up for them and cleaning up after them when they can do it for themselves. Any child over the age of, say, 9 or 10 ought to be helping you with the house chores. They may not do it as good as you do it. But I was vacuuming, I was cleaning, I was dusting, and when Mom came home, she re-vacuumed and she re-dusted because she didn't like the way I did it. But she at least got me involved, and I knew how to do it, and I could clean the house. I could mow the yard. Discouragement. Lack of understanding your child. Discouragement is number five. The lack of understanding your child brings discouragement to them. When you don't sit down and talk with them about the rules and God's word, and you don't talk to them about what they're to do and not to do, it brings discouragement to them. Lack of reward. We're very good as parents at saying, "No, no, no." But when do you ever say, "Yes, yes, yes, I'm proud of you. You did great. That was wonderful. Man, thank you so much for doing that." Failing to sacrifice. Failing to give your time for them. There's a little boy in our church. His dad came home and his dad was a workaholic, much like my dad. He tried to do everything he could to save money, so he changed the oil in his own car. And that night after work, man, you know what it's like to come home after work and you're tired, you're physically given out, and you can't wait to get to the recliner and rest a little bit before you have to get up early in the morning and do it all over again. So he went down in the basement, he pulled out the oil pan, and he pulled out the tools that he was going to change the oil in the car, and he could see his little boy walking around the car. And he called his name. He said, "What do you want?" He said, "I just thought we could throw the football for a little while." That dad's heart broke, and he got out from under that car, and he went outside and threw the football with that little boy. He said, "I was going to throw the football until he was done. I was going to throw it until he didn't want to throw it anymore. He had to go to school, had to go to bed sometimes." So he said, "I just started." He said, "In 15 minutes, he said, okay, Dad, I'm going to go back inside now." That's all he wanted was 15 minutes of his dad's time. And the dad still got the oil changed in the car, and they still both got to bed in time. All he wanted, all that boy wanted was 15 minutes of him and his dad throwing the football. And he said, "Okay, Dad, thanks." Sacrifice your time loving your children and letting them know that you'll put aside anything for them. Sacrifice. Trying to get them to grow up sooner than they're supposed to. Never spank them for spilling something unless you had told them not to play with it. They're going to spill stuff. They're going to break stuff. They're going to drop stuff. They're uncoordinated children. You ever seen a teenager when they go through that uncoordinated stage? They spill everything. They spill plates. They don't spank them for that. Those are accidents. You spill stuff. Don't spank them for falling. You fall. Spank them when you've told them what to do and you've given them instruction and they go against that instruction. So don't as a parent cause them to grow up sooner than they should. Let them make mistakes. Let them fail. That teaches them. Don't do their homework for them. They fail in an assignment, sit them down and say, "Let me show you how to do this the right way. Let me show you why you didn't. Let's find out why you failed in that project. And let's teach you." If you're doing the homework for them, they're not learning. You're learning. Didn't you have enough school? Aren't you tired of doing homework? Amen. Let them do it for a change. And let them turn something in late. It's not going to hurt them. It's not going to ruin their school career. But they are going to learn about schedules. If you don't let them learn, then they're not going to be as productive. And they will find themselves frustrated because they're just used to you doing it for them. I know. There were times I knew if I did not clean my room, Mom would eventually come in and clean it for me. Dad learned that I learned that, and Dad set me straight on that. Neglect. abusive words, physical abuse. Corporal punishment and physical abuse are totally opposite things. Corporal punishment, you're in control of the situation. You're trying to teach your child and discipline them for something they've done wrong. Physical abuse is when you've lost your temper and in furious rage you begin to act out on an innocent, pure little child that can't take care of themselves. That is wicked and wrong, and you should never physically abuse a child. The Bible says in the next verse, the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. Proverbs chapter 29 and verse 15, the Bible says, a child left to himself bringeth his mother shame. That is the truth. Children take instruction. It takes time. It takes study. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23, the Bible says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. In Mark chapter 7 and verse 21, Jesus said that about the heart. In Luke chapter 6 and verse 45, he said it's a heart problem. There's a heart problem. When there is a change of behavior and there is no change of the heart, all you've done is corrected their behavior. I saw it in my life when I thought Dad didn't know what he was talking about. I didn't care what Dad said. I was going to do it my way. And when I got out of college and I realized, or when I got out of high school and I started college and I realized the world didn't care about me, and that man that had been teaching me, and that man that got up early to pay for the bills and pay for the food in my house and to pay for the school that I was doing, that man that got up at 5:30 in the morning and prayed for me over his tenderloin biscuit, that man cared about me. The professor didn't care about me. The boss on the job didn't care about me. But that man had given himself to feed me and house me and clothe me and love me. From that moment on, he didn't have to tell me to mow the yard. I tried to race him home to mow the yard so he wouldn't have to do it anymore. Are you understanding? There wasn't a change in my behavior. There was a change in my heart. I really started loving my dad like I should have loved him all along. I wanted to help him, and I wanted to honor him instead of being the kid that he had to say, I want the yard mowed. In a last-ditch effort, cranking that thing at 4:30 before he got home, running around that yard like a madman. I didn't have no zero degree riding mower. We had a self-propelled mower that the self-propulsion motor broke, so we pushed the self-propelled mower around and mowed the yard. And man, Dad, I knew when he was coming home. I knew what time he got home from work. I'd run around that house. And then we didn't have a weed eater. I mean, kids, I had it terrible. It was bad growing up in my day. We had these sideways scissors that you had to take and trim on your knees. You had to take and trim the sidewalks, and you had to take and trim the driveway. And I mean, I would get that done. I'd put everything up, wash the lawnmower. My dad washed his lawnmower. Washed. What? Crazy man washes his lawnmower. I would wash the lawnmower. I would put it up. I'd go running into the living room, lay down. Dad would come in and say, man, he did a great job. I did that a long time ago. Got that done plenty of time. Thanks, Dad. Looks good, son. The stripes are straight. You did a good job. Are you listening to it? Did you do that? I did that. There's a change in behavior, but no change of the heart. There's a lot of Christians like that. They say they're saved, and they've stopped doing the old things they used to do, but they still have not had a heart change. They got this change, they haven't got this change. There's a difference. What we're looking for in our children is we're looking for a heart change. We're just not wanting them to do the behavior right. We're wanting them to have a relationship with an eternal God. That's parenting. That's Christian parenting, is wanting them to have a relationship with God instead of just behaving correctly. The problem with your child's heart is they're not mature. They're not self-controlled. They're not obedient. They have a lack of understanding. They have a lack of experience. So you're going to, in time, you're going to give to them those things: maturity, self-control, obedience, understanding, and experience. The problem is that they're born into this world sinful, and you have to deal with that sinful heart to get them to see the need of salvation. The goal of parenting is get them to salvation and sanctification. The goal of parenting is not to get them under control. Teachers can control it. The teachers in this church, it amazes me how I walk back in children's church or Awana's, and at sometimes these teachers, they have these ways about them. I don't know how they do it. I don't know how they teach those kids. I mean, I would be back there in children's church as youth director. Okay, quiet down. Okay, that's it. Be quiet. Stop talking. I'm going to take away gym time if you don't stop talking. And then they would get quiet. I've seen Amber Flippin walk into that room and put her hand up like this, and every one of those kids. You know what? You were back there. Amber would put her hand up. Man, those kids acted like Hitler had walked in the room. Those school teachers have a way of controlling. Parenting is not just getting control. The coach can control them. Grandparents can get control. You need control of them, but that's not parenting. Parenting is not teaching them how to be polite or respectful. Teaching them how to behave. Parenting is not teaching them how to be obedient. This is part of parenting. Parenting is not performing to get your approval. That's not what you're doing. You're not teaching them to entertain you or do right so they can get your approval. This is what Christian parenting is. It's teaching that child there is a holy and a righteous God, and they are a sinner, and Jesus died for sinners, and you want them to know Jesus so they can go to heaven with you when they die. That's Christian parenting. All of that comes along with it. The obedience, the self-control, all of that comes with it. The knowledge, the experience. Christian parenting is getting your child to know Jesus and salvation. Everything else is simply behavior modification. My dad did behavioral modification. He took the rod of knowledge and planted it. He took the rod of correction and planted it to the seed of my understanding. But what he taught me is why he was doing that. Why I was the way I was. And he would say, you're not a bad boy. You're not bad. But there's a heart inside of you that is bad, sinful. And if you'll let God control that heart, son, you won't do these sins. Call it sin. You know what our world has started telling parents? They lack self-esteem. No, they don't. Have you been around them? Have you seen them? We took some videos down to get them digitized. And just tapes we had down in the basement. I didn't know what they were. I didn't know if any of them were good. Some of them were of Tig playing golf, and some of them were his hunting trips. But we got videos back that Camille and Claudia had recorded, and we did not know they had recorded. The secret, your Father which seeth in secret will reward you openly. So Camille was videoing Claudia. Now let me say, Camille is not a videographer. She's not running those cameras. She's got ADD so bad, it was, this is the light, this is the, and the whole time you're getting seasick watching her. This is my daughter, this is my sister, this is my mom, this is my dad, this is the living room. Finally, they're up in the bedroom, they're alone, I think they're alone, God is watching. They're videoing, and she videos Claudia. She said, this is my sister. She thinks she's all that. She's not. She's stupid. She started listing these characteristics of Claudia. And then she said, and she's crazy. And all I heard on the camera was Claudia go, that's it! The next thing you know, the camera goes flying through the air. And you can hear Camille saying, quit, quit. Mom and Dad are going to hear. I got to get the camera. It's still recording. And you could hear them in the background. And Claudia just whooping the tar out of Camille. I don't know what it was about crazy. She called her 10 different names. But when she said, she's crazy, Claudia said, that's it. They are self-absorbed little beings that if you don't teach them what is right, they'll just go on their own way doing their own thing, because we all as human beings are broken. We are sinful. So you think or may think that your children need self-esteem. They don't need self-esteem. They come into this world with all, they think it's all about them. You ever had a baby cry in the middle of the night when they're supposed to be asleep and you think something's wrong? You think that the baby needs help, and when you go in, as soon as you look into that bassinet or that bed, they go to laughing, "Hey, Ma, I ain't got a thing wrong, just needed some attention." Liar! They lied to you. They didn't know they lied. Didn't have any idea that that was a lie, but when I would teach my girls, when we disciplined our girls, I make them name it. Say, "Now listen, didn't I tell you? Yeah. Your room's not clean." What is that? Disobedience, Dad. "Didn't I tell you?" Yeah. "Didn't you tell me?" Yeah. And it wasn't true. No. What's that? It's a lie. And you can ask my daughters to this day, they quote this verse word for word. "All liars shall have their part in the lake of fire, which burneth with fire and brimstone." You say, you tell your children about hell? Yes. Tell your children that there's a place that they can go to if they don't accept Christ as their Savior. Don't tell them every night. Don't tell them 40 times a day. But they need to know about God. I'll tell you in a minute what to tell them. But the world has said they need self-esteem. They don't need self-esteem. They've got self-esteem. What they need is a parent to guide them to realize that in their heart they need Christ. And when they have Christ, they've got the greatest friend they ever need. The anthem of that self-esteem movement was Whitney Houston's song, "The Greatest Love of All." What a beautiful song, preacher. I love that song. That's an atheistic view of loving yourself. And that's what's wrong with America today. That's what's wrong with the world today. The greatest love of all is not loving yourself. The greatest love of all is to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy mind, and with all thy spirit. That's the greatest love. You do have to love yourself, because he said, "Love your neighbor as yourself." There has to be some self-love so you have confidence that you can do the things that you need to do. But the greatest love of all is not self-esteem. The greatest love of all is to know the giver of love, the God of love, and his Son, Jesus Christ. So if you're raising children, these are the things that you need to teach them from a very young age. When they're ready for it, you'll know. You'll say, "How do I know?" They'll start asking questions. Do they not? If you've parented somebody to adulthood, do they not sit in the car seat in the back and say, "Daddy, God loves me, doesn't he?" "Oh, yes, sweetheart. God does love you." "Daddy, I'm not saved, am I?" "No, not yet." Waiting for the Lord to speak to you and you to answer. "Daddy, I want to get saved." You ever heard them say that? What a day. We were riding to Arigato's Japanese Steakhouse in a white 2002 Suburban. And Claudia in the back seat, nothing really major going on, no major conversations going on. In fact, I think it was silent in the car. And from the back seat, I don't know what she was thinking, I don't know where it came from, but she said, "Daddy, I want to get saved." And I said, "What?" She said, "I want to ask Jesus to come into my heart." Boy, as quick as I could, I pulled that Suburban over, and right there on the side of 52, led that little girl to Jesus Christ. Where did she learn that? She learned it by having a mom and dad that brought her up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. Number one, teach your children that God is loving and holy. Number one, teach them that God is loving and holy, that he is right. He's always right. He's never done wrong. He is pure and clean, and he will always be that way. He's not always been that way. He's not only always been that way, he has always been holy. He is now holy, and he will always be holy. And then begin to teach your children that the things that they do are sin. That's why I made them name it. Disobey. What's disobedience? It's a sin. What's a lie? It's a sin. Deceitfulness, when they wouldn't tell us the truth but tried to deceive us. What is deceitfulness? It's a sin, Daddy. They need to know it's not low self-esteem. That's not their problem. Sin is their problem. Teach them about sin. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Memorize these verses. Mark them down. Put them on note cards. Amy would put them on note cards in their room, things that they were working with, things that they were developing in their adolescence and things in their teenage years. She would put the verses on note cards at their mirror where they would get ready so they could see those verses. But the Bible tells us to take the Word of God in Deuteronomy and put them on the heart of our children. Put those verses everywhere. Then teach them that God is holy and you have sinned, but Jesus came to die for those that are sinners. Jesus, as God, came to this earth to give himself for sin. I'm about to shout right there. Jesus came to this earth to die for sinful Zane Fischel. Because of his sin, Jesus came to the cross of Calvary and died. He who knew no sin was made sin for you, Zane. I remember my dad saying that, just like he's sitting right up here on this platform. He became sin for you in what you just did. He died on the cross for the lie that you just told. I'm going to discipline you, but God loves you greater than I do, and God wants you to do right. I remember my dad saying that. I remember him telling me that and doing it with tears in his eyes. Teach them that Jesus Christ came to die for sinners. When they realize they're a sinner, say, there's a way out. You don't have to stay that way. Number four, teach them that Jesus not only died for sinners, but then he overcame death and got up from death, hell, and the grave. Teach them, Romans chapter 4 and verse 25, teach them that he paid for our sins, then he conquered death, he conquered hell, and he conquered sin for you to be saved and know him as your Savior. Number one, teach them that he's holy. Number two, teach them that they have sin and they're sinful. Number three, teach them that Jesus died for sinners. Number four, teach them that Jesus raised from the dead. That is the greatest miracle in your Bible, is that Jesus Christ proved he was God by coming up out of that grave and raised himself from the dead. He is God. The one that can do that is God. And that little girl, that little boy needs to know who God is. Then God asks us for a response to those truths. I am holy. I am love. I showed you my love by sending Christ to die on the cross for your sins. And he rose again, so when you die, you may have eternal life. It's simple. It's so simple that a child can understand it. Now, God says, I want a response. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. The Spirit and the bride say, come, take of the water of life freely. This truth right here, I know of two men in our church sitting right here right now. You need to be saved. I know you need to be saved. Your family's told me that you're lost. You've come in service after service after service. Right now, why don't you respond and say, I believe that. I know that I'm a sinner. I know that Jesus loved me and died for me. I know that Jesus rose again. Why don't you respond to God today and let Christ come into your heart? If you take these truths and teach them to your children and then do it in a loving way, parenting is a hard job, an expensive job, but it is so worth it when they get to be adults and you're sitting with them in church and you can look over and see them and maybe your grandkids and you see that the ones that you know are going to heaven because you took the time to parent them. Nurture and admonition of the Lord. Listen to those two words. Nurture, loving care, admonition of the Lord is for you to praise them and exhort them to do what is right. It is not beating them down. It's not crushing their will. Instead, it's allowing them to see that their will must be turned over to God and live in God's will. Hallelujah. Amen. How early should I begin to teach this? As early as you can. As quick as you can. When I first felt my daughters in my arms, I felt the great burden and pressure to have these two children indebted to me, teach them as a father. In private devotion, I've committed myself to raise my daughters in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord, and have tried. Many times I've failed as a father, but I have tried to give them the very best of me. Prayed over them when they were sick. Laughed at their childish antics and their jokes. Spent many times with them at parks and fishing and all the things that dads do. Delighted watching them play sports. Finished school, and now Claudia will graduate in December from college. Tried to give them a home that was pleasant. I have deep anxiety constantly for their spiritual condition. I have two good girls. I know they're saved. If you're a parent and you have adult children, you do have deep anxiety. Are they close to you, God? Are they serving you, Lord? Is there The Bible says about that prodigal son who joined himself to a citizen of a far country. Is there a citizen trying to take them away from church, from you? I prayed over their salvation and have tried to promote and nurture their spiritual welfare. At home as well as when they left home, I'm still trying to nurture their spiritual welfare. I want them to be and know God in an intimate way. For when this life ends, I dearly love you, church. You're my friends. But there are only three people in this world that I want there when this life is over. Some of you may be there. Some were gathered around Teague's deathbed when he died. Some of his closest friends. And some of you may be there when I die. I would welcome that. But there's only three that I desperately want there. And that's Amy and Camille and Claudia. And I want to know that when I leave this life, I will see them again. And that they will teach my grandchildren how to go where I'm going. Fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. Bring them up. Not push them down. Bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. God has a plan for parenting. It's in that book right there. We have a great couples class. Well, there's probably a dozen or more, two dozen couples in our church that are going through the same terrible twos and terrific threes and horrible fours or whatever you're going through. And they can say, this is what we did and this is how it worked. You need your church family. There's support. That's why God planned it the way He planned it. And we'll talk about the church next week. He put us together so we could grow together, raise our families together, and find and search and look for answers in the Word of God. Apologize. Children are the most forgiving people you'll find on this earth as a parent if you'll go to them and say, I'm sorry. I said that wrong. I did that wrong. I said that out of anger. And your children will be the most terrific forgivers in your life. You're going to make mistakes. I made mistakes. But the thing that I do know is that those two girls and those two son-in-laws that I have are saved and on their way to heaven. And when this life is over, I will leave this life knowing it'll just be for a little while, and I will see them again. That is parenting. That is Christian parenting. And if you're doing it today, you ought to pray and ask God to help you through every stage. They will be some of the sweetest, loving, cuddling kids you've ever had. And then when they turn into a teenager, you won't get a word out of them, and they'll turn to some of the meanest demons you've ever seen. At the age of 13, all of a sudden it hits them. Wham! They're a teenager. And in 7 years, they put you through torment and persecution. And then they get into their 20s, and there's something about a 20-year-old when they're out on their own, working their own job, paying their own rent, going to college. It changes. It flips. Mark Twain said this: it was amazing how much my dad had learned from the time I was 17 and I left home and I returned when I was 21. His dad hadn't learned anything. Mark Twain's the one that learned. 13 to 20. You're good at math. Subtract that. How many years is that? 7 years of tribulation. You're going to go through the adolescent stages. You're going to go through bullying. You're going to go through hurt, boyfriends, girlfriends, breakups, heartbreak. Hopefully never divorces, but you may go through divorces. Their 20s and their 30s. It is the greatest job you can have on this earth. It's the most rewarding job you can have on this earth. But it is a hard, expensive, difficult job. And it's worth it. If when you leave this world, you know following you and coming right behind you, the pitter-patter of those little feet, those little children are going to follow you to heaven. But I've watched many parents lead their children to hell, and I cannot stop it. All I can do is raise mine. All I can do is warn you in this pulpit what you're to do. Now God wants a response. You must respond. You will one way or the other. You'll reject it, accept God's way. You'll do it God's way or you won't do it God's way. You say, well, I don't want to bring them to church and tell them what to believe. You better tell them what to believe. Because somebody's going to tell them what to believe. And they're going to listen to somebody, and it's better they listen to you because you're the one that loves them and cares for them like nobody else. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes?